Willie Davidson. I'm at Simon Fraser University, Department of Molecular Biology and Biochemistry.
Leonard Foster, University of British Columbia, Departments of Biochemistry and Molecular Biology of the Michael Smith Laboratory.
I'm Chelsea Hunter. I'm the leader for veterinary science and diagnostics for the BC Division of Agriculture and an assistant professor at UBC.
Thank you. My name is Jenny Romero. I'm the manager of innovation for the Ministry of Agriculture. And thank you so much to the OBC for the opportunity to participate in this symposium and be part of this exciting panel. So first of all, I'm going to provide an overview of the ministry priorities, the Ministry of Agriculture priorities, as well as a little bit of information about our innovation programs in the ministry. So in terms of what guides our work, we have recently refreshed our strategic plan, and that the vision that we have in the ministry remains. So our vision is to be an innovative, adaptive, and globally competitive agri-food and seafood sector valued by all British Columbians. So as I mentioned recently, in last December, the ministry released a new strategic growth plan for the province, for the sector. And this is the plan that is going to direct all of our initiatives and actions in the ministry for the next 5 years. So that's from 2015 to 2020. A significant goal of our strategic growth plan is to continue focusing on economic growth. We have a goal to increase revenues to $15 billion per year by 2020. Our sector is performing quite well right now, so we have achieved an approximate revenue of $14 billion per year. So we still have some room to grow, but again, the sector is performing quite well. So in terms of our pillars for the strategic growth plan, we're focusing on increasing production, driving competitiveness, and building markets. So in terms of increasing production, we speak about increasing yields, increasing the land that is used in agriculture, and probably exploring and putting new land that is not identified as agricultural land to be included in agriculture. And seafood. In terms of driving competitiveness, we speak about increasing the margin, the profit margin for our crops and seafood, and also increasing the productivity of our labor. And in terms of building markets, we continue to focus on building a very strong domestic market, as well as eliminating the interprovincial barriers, as well as the international trade barriers. So again, this is a significant focus on exports of our seafood and agricultural products. Another significant strategic piece for us is the Growing Forward 2 multilateral policy framework. The Growing Forward 2 agreement is a partnership between the federal government, the provinces, and the territories. It's a 5 year program from 2013 to 2018, and it's a total of $3 billion for investment in the sector. So all of our GF2 programs focus on innovation, competitiveness, and market development. We enable the sector to innovate and focus on their competitiveness while also providing the insurance that the producers and the processors need to deal with changes in the markets, the environment, etc. In terms of our GF2 programs, our Growing Forward programs in the province, in British Columbia, we have four main streams. We have the innovation programs, the competitiveness and market development programs, adaptability and industry capacity programs, and the business risk management programs. In terms of the strategic context, we have identified three key drivers for our sector. So, as I mentioned earlier, we are leveraging opportunities to realize significant economic growth, as well as preparing for the challenges and opportunities of climate change. This is a significant focus right now for the ministry, as well as for the province. The province is drafting the climate action plan right now that should allow British Columbia and other sectors to be more resilient to climate change, as well as to take advantage of the opportunities that may result from climate change. And finally, the other driver that we have identified for our sector is to ensure that all these British Columbians have the ability to secure their food supply. And in terms of the genomics and agriculture opportunity, I think that there is a huge opportunity to see how many of the initiatives in genomics could support the goals that we have within the ministry. For instance, we can consider breeding and genomics for increased crop yields, improving crop resistance to environmental stressors, as I mentioned, climate change, social, etc. bring higher quality seafood and livestock or growing more nutrient-rich foods. In terms of the GFCO innovation programs again for the province, these programs enable entrepreneurs, producers, processors to actually move from their idea to the commercialization. So we kind of the risk that is a de-risking initiative really for our innovators. So we have three programs in place. The first one is the Canada BC Agri Innovation Program, which is delivered by the Investment Agriculture Foundation, IIF. So this is 60% of our funding goes through IIF. This is approximately 14 million from 2013 to 2018. And we have a very broad range of projects. We support food processing, agri technology, all the many commodities that we have in the province. We have over 200 commodities in British Columbia. So we have also some projects that support what we call agrigenomics or genomics for application in agriculture. A couple of examples are reducing the amount of volatile acidity in wine through gene deletion. Also, the development of a point of care PCR diagnostic platform and sales for the poultry industry. So another program that we have in the ministry, so the first program is what we call kind of the industry-led program. So we have industry associations, researchers, entrepreneurs, producers, processors coming through IIF for funding. The Provincial Significant Projects Program is what we call the government-led program. So similar to the previous one, we provide funding that allows entrepreneurs or people in the industry to make their to move to commercialization. We support latest stage research, prototyping, demonstration, all the way to commercialization. The Provincial Significant Projects are identified by staff within the ministry, but they often are collaboration with industry associations or the producers on the ground. And finally, we have the Climate Adaptation Program. The Climate Adaptation Program is delivered by the Climate Action Initiative. It is 20% of our funding, which is approximately 5 million or 6 million from 2013 to 2018. The Climate Adaptation Program is mostly a collaboration between different levels of governments. So we have municipal governments, industry associations, coming together to identify the main stressors that can result from climate change and identify actions and initiatives that would allow the producers again to be more resilient, be prepared for climate change, think long-term, and finally also consider how to take advantage of the potential challenges or the opportunities that climate change is going to bring to us. So with that, I just want to leave it. I just want to mention basically as provincial government, the innovation programs really are a huge support to many entrepreneurs in the agri-food and seafood sector, and we are often searching for the potential for partnerships, including GenomeBC, which we have some partnerships already. And today we're going to hear about two of the programs that we're currently funding under the GFT program, the Provincial Significant Project. So Chelsea and Dr. Foster will also speak about some of these projects, and again, we continue to look forward to partnering with them.
So before I begin, I want to thank Katie for inviting me to speak today, and also Demi for introducing the session. So I think we all know what the problem is, or at least the global problem is. It's that population continues to rise, and the agricultural land base does not. And so we're sort of between a rock and a hard place. And the real challenge then, this is only one part of the answer, is to develop more productive, sustainable, and resilient crops. And what I mean by sustainable crops are those that require fewer inputs. We simply cannot sustainably continue to use as much water, fertilizer, and pesticides, and so forth in our in production. And so one potential approach to addressing this challenge, which I'm not the only one that's doing this, is to use genomic and computational tools to identify and introduce alleles or genes from wild squirrelfowl relatives of crop plants into cultivated land. So one thing that happened during domestication and improvement is that there were bottlenecks that resulted in a lot of diversity. And many of these wild genes that were lost during domestication actually are the things that allow those wild species to survive in extreme habitats. What we have to do is to identify these and bring them back into the cultivars. So I work mainly with sunflowers and the sunflower family, and probably in BC we don't grow many of these, so I thought I would introduce you to the crop. It's a globally important crop. It's worth about $20 billion in terms of production value. It's between 11 and 13 in terms of the most important crop in terms of acreage grown. What's really interesting about this group, which is sort of attracting me to it, is that it has a large number of cross-compatible wild species that you can bring genes into the cultivated sunflower. And these provide sources of tolerance to key abiotic stresses as well as biotic ones. These are things like drought, salt, flooding, and low nutrient stress. These are the stresses that we're targeting. And so we've taken a fairly systematic approach to mining this diversity. What we did, and I'm going to give you some data, we took the 22 species that we can make crosses with the cultivated sunflower. We genotyped about 300 individuals. We made a tree. This is what we call a network. And we chose about 25 representatives from this network that sort of encompass the genetic diversity of the cross-compatible wild species. Then we did something that's called pre-breeding. And essentially what we did, we took these 25 wild donors, we back-crossed them a couple times into an elite line, and then self them a couple times. And the reason that you do this is that breeders do not want to work with wild material. It's full of things that they don't want, either incompatibilities, traits that are not conducive to production. But if you bring them in into a cultivated background, you can then figure out how those traits actually will perform in a cultivated background. You also get rid of many of the incompatibilities. So this was a huge amount of work. It was just one thing that's going on in the lab. The person who really spearheaded this is Greg Boddy down here with the sunflowers in the corner. And once we had these, yes, there is a genomic component. What we did was we then genotyped these with an approach called genotyping by sequencing. It says more GPS there. Have I talked about GPS before? No. Oh, yes, I guess I did here. Essentially what we do is we take each of the pre-bred lines and find out what part of each chromosome in sunflower or other species comes from the wild donor. And this allows us not only to know, allows us ultimately to correlate those intragress regions or those blocks from the donor species to phenotypic traits of interest. And then we did an evaluation last summer. And we did this both in Uganda and in Europe. And this is Walter, he's our sunflower breeder in Uganda, and he planted them out in three different locations in Uganda that vary in terms of total precipitation. And the results were really stunning. I'm just going to show you, we only have a small amount of time, and I've been warned I can't remember, so. But this shows, you can see these are the pre-bred lines. This is the most drought affected plot, and you can see that all the sort of elites, they just completely died, and yet there's some of the pre-bred lines that are doing just fine. And so we have some real winners. We also, perhaps from a commercial perspective, something that, well, okay, I have 5 minutes left, I've been going fast, okay. So I can slow down here. So drought is a really big deal, by the way. It's been estimated that, for example, in southern France, they lose $7 million a day to drought. So even a 20% increase in drought tolerance would, I think it's calculated, 3.6 million per day. In Canada, it's a little bit of a different story. It's more of a flood tolerance, which we are going after as well. But drought will become a problem in the near future, I suspect. Anyways, what was really exciting from this, though, is oil content. So sunflower is an oilseed crop. It's a $20 billion made from selling oil for food. And you can see where the cultivated parent is. It's about 45% oil content. We had some pre-bred lines that were 20% more. up to 56% oil content. Those are worth a lot of money. And so we're actually going after those now. What we're doing now is we've been correlating these introgressions to particular phenotypes, for example, oil content and grout, and we're functionally characterizing candidate genes that underlie those traits, and we're also working with companies as well as the public sector to move, using marker-assisted selection, to move some of these key regions into elite cultivars and hopefully the cultivars. And I also should say that we have collaborations with some industry, some companies to commercialize some of the most valuable merchants. And so, thank you. The people who really did this are shown here. Greg Bowdy is a student in my lab, and he was the one who did most of the pre-reading for his PhD, and just an enormous amount of work. He just finished up. Then, Elena Albrecht is the molecular breeder at Soltis, a sunflower breeding company that helped us with the genotyping by sequencing and evaluations, and of course, Walter is our collaborator in Canada. So, thank you.
Doesn't matter. You can see that from about the mid-1980s to about the mid-1990s, there was a huge drop in the commercial harvest of cocoa sap. It went from over 100,000 metric tons to just under 17,000 metric tons in 10 years, and that put restrictions on the commercial fishery. During this time, the salmon enhancement program was initiated by the Department of Fisheries and Oceans, and it was designed to produce coho salmon in their 12 federal hatcheries, and so enhance and maintain the population. Unfortunately, the trend doesn't appear to have been successful so far, and this is despite the 12 federal hatcheries releasing every year about 3.65 million smolts. There are also community hatcheries, and the 38 hatcheries in BC produce annually almost 5 million smolts. What we do know is that the coho that you find in the Salish Sea, about 70% of them actually originated from hatcheries. We also know that marine survival has dropped dramatically from about 15%. That means if you 100 smolts go out, 15 of them return as adults, down to 1%. We don't know why, but we can guess. What's rather ironic is that as the wild production in Canada fell, global agriculture of coho increased. And this is primarily in Chile, where today they produce more than 150,000 metric tons. And that's worth over $1 billion US. Their broodstock originated in Canada. If we take a look at what the coho fishery contributes to the BC economy. This is a comparison in blue 1990 to red 2011. We see that in the past, the captive fishery has been high. Now it's down to less than a third. Whereas the sports fishery on the right, let's look at it, has stayed fairly level. Our hope, our desire, is to maintain the sports fishery while enhancing the capture fishery. So EPIC 4 wants to provide safe, secure coho salmon production. We take these terms, of course, from the call for proposals. So what are we going to do? It's a genomics project. We're going to develop a reference genome for coho salmon. We're going to look at conservation units using genotyping by sequencing. We're going to ask, what is the genetic variation among all the populations? How are the genetic variants distributed? And do they relate in any way to the conditions that the different salmon populations, coho salmon populations, find themselves in? We're going to try and address the question about hatchery efficiency. What would happen, for example, if we actually closed all the hatcheries? Would coho salmon become extinct? It's unthinkable and impossible to even undertake those any one hatchery closing. So we're going out with a different approach. We're using genomics. We're asking family assessment. Does each family that's produced in a hatchery have the same survival at sea, for example? Do they all come back as three-year-olds, or is there a large proportion that come back as two-year-olds? So we're looking at genetic markers for survival, growth, and pathogen load, particularly bacterial kidney disease. We're also developing a new method. Now, I should say that a lot of this work is done in collaboration with Fisheries and Oceans at the Nanaimo Lab, with Teddy Beecham and Ruth Whittler in particular, and Bob Devlin at the West Van Lab. We're asking, can we use parentage-based tagging as a means of looking at salmon, taking a DNA sample, backtracking, asking who its parents were, knowing where the parents were bred, then we can tell which hatchery that fish came from. We can also then tell whose brothers and sisters were, and we can look for trends within families, look for trends within hatcheries, look at different hatchery practices, and ask, is there one which is better than some of the others? We're also going to be working with groups in Chile, where the aquaculture industry for coho is, and we will be looking for markers for more efficient agriculture. We, of course, have an integrated gels component I can't speak about that because I'm not very familiar with it, but I should let you know that it's there, and we have an excellent team of social scientists who are going to evaluate some of how the knowledge is transferred, for example, and what are the barriers to picking it up in government agencies. Take you through a little bit of the Coho Salmon heritage-based tagging pilot study. Traditionally, or at the moment, we use coded wire tags. So when a fish is produced, the coho is produced in a government hatchery. It gets its adipose fin clipped as a smolt, and then it gets a little metal tag stuck in its head. If you're a fisherman, if you catch a coho that doesn't have an adipose fin, then you cut off its head, if you keep it, and you put this into the tag recovery lab. They go in, pull out a little metal tag, and identify where the fish came from. They can only tell which hatchery it came from. They can't tell about anything about the parent fish. So we're going to be looking using genomics to do that. Some results to date. The federal government last year actually put $2 million into the Pacific Salmon Foundation. There's a concern about the Salish Sea marine survival. In terms of the genome sequencing, we've already almost completed the genome in terms of generating all the raw reads. We have a transcriptome that was published, and we were very fortunate in Bob Devlin producing a double haploid fish, which allowed us to go ahead with this. The landscape genomics, we've got about 80% of the samples collected, and they're being genotyped in Quebec at Louis Bernatchez's lab. And we are well on the way in doing a parentage-based tagging in terms of having collected all the sites. This slide is for Roger. He said we should always finish up with a slide which shows how we're going to progress through the project and how it gets in, how the bits interact. So Roger, this one's for you. Thank you. And these are the people.
Thank you very much, and thanks to Gabe for the invitation, and apologies to Roger that I don't have the slides this afternoon for you. But I'm going to start by thanking some people and then thanking the rest of the people at the end. This is a project now that's building on about 7 years of funding from Genome BC and Genome Canada and many other sources. This is a thank you to all the commercial beekeepers that we've worked with over the last 3 to 4 years to get to where we are at right now. So to set the stage, this is the situation the honeybee industry is facing right now. The historic levels of losses that the bee industry expects to have year over year, somewhere around 15% or so, and the two different colors here are Canada versus the United States, and for the most part, we mirror one another. And then in 2006-2007, if you didn't have your head under a rock, you heard that bees were dying all over the world. And the rates went up to about 30%. They stayed relatively high. There were some dips. Now there's quite a large divergence in Canada and the US. This is partly because the US started counting things differently than we did. By and large, well, this last year may or may not be an anomaly, but by and large, bees have been dying at rates that make industrial beekeeping unsustainable. So the main causes of those, contrary to the neonicotinoid coverage in the press, the main causes are infectious diseases and pests. And primarily those are the varroa mites, which is shown up here. The varroa mite is the vector for several viruses that are probably at least as damaging as the mite itself. And then there are other bacterial diseases. Yeah, the second leading cause of death is a microsporidium called Docima. And we have methods for treating these, but for the most part, those are becoming less and less effective. The pests and pathogens are developing resistance, But these also have other means of defense. They have an innate immune system, but where we're most interested is in social immunity. And these are behaviors that bees exhibit that collectively as a colony allow them to defend against the disease, whereas an innate immune pathway really protects an individual. Social immunity protects the colony. And the one that we're most interested in is this something called hygienic behavior. And the goal really of our projects leading up to where we're at now and then looking forward is to develop methods for selecting bees that are naturally resistant. So we don't have to use or rely on the chemicals that have been used so far to try and control all these pests and pathogens. So their breeding in bees is not very advanced, let's say, compared to most other areas of agriculture or significant areas, that is. There's ways to select for some of these behaviors, these disease-resistant behaviors, and one of them is shown here, the hygienic behavior test, but it's laborious and not very efficient, and actually the field test is not all that reliable unless you pay very close attention to what you're doing. So what we're trying to do is develop methods to use protein levels to select for disease resistance. And this is a bit of a twist. We're using the protein expression levels rather than genomic markers. And I'll have a word to say about that at the end. But this hygienic behavior, just to describe it a little bit more, what you saw in the previous slide was we were freeze-killing larvae of bees using liquid nitrogen. And then we put those dead larvae back into the colony. And in a hygienic colony, they'll clean it all out and get it ready for the queen to lay new eggs in. In a non-hygienic colony, they won't. And a hygienic colony is much better able to resist disease because it's removing those dead and dying larvae more quickly and keeping a cleaner colony. And it's essentially the same as washing your hands after you go to the washroom. And so what we did over several years was to correlate protein expression profiles in antenna of bees, where we also were able to measure the hygienic behavior of those bees. I'm showing you two of the results here. The proteins are listed in the top. You can see this, this expression level of the protein is positively correlated. This protein expression level is negatively correlated with hygienic behavior. And we came up with a panel of 13 markers like that seem to correlate very well, positively or negatively, with hygienic behavior. Then, over the last few years, we put that to the test in an industrial breeding program where we compare the classic method for selecting for hygienic behavior with the use of these markers, and then we have a couple of controls in there as well. And so we went through all that. This is where we the picture I showed at the beginning of all the commercial beekeeping operations where they got involved. We were doing this across the four western provinces. There were started off with nearly 40 commercial operations. In the end, we were working with the 12 largest ones, which collectively represent nearly 10% of the entire industry in Canada, and going through several rounds of breeding and then giving offspring back to those beekeepers for them to test. And then we also did some tests in our own experimental apiaries. And this is one of them that I think I'm going to show you two results that I think really hit home the effectiveness of this approach. So what we're doing here is infecting colonies with what is probably the most lethal pathogen of bees. It's a bacterial disease, and it can take down a colony within a few weeks if it's given at high enough levels. And so I won't go into the details, but we're basically infecting these bees with an infectious dose that should kill about 80 or 90% of bees. So we gave these bees this infection. The bees were either marker assisted selected using the liquid nitrogen test, or unselected, either Canadian bees or imported bees. And the results are shown here. the first and third generations of the selected genes, either using the free-skilled assay or the markers, are shown here. So first, F1 is black, F3 is gray, and this is survival. You can see we're getting reasonably high survival for those that are selected using the classic method, but the markers seem to be performing at a reasonably competitive level as well, compared to the controls, which, as I said, this is about the expected level where you get about 80 or 90% kill in these. So the markers seem to be working, but the problem is this is really not the biggest concern of beekeepers. The biggest concern of beekeepers is the varroa mite, as I said. So what we did was take a whole bunch of bees that were very highly infested with these mites. You put them into a big box and basically mix them all up, and they really like this. And then you weigh out a kilogram of bees and put those back into a colony that is headed by a queen that is selected in one of the two methods or unselected. And then we let those go for a year and see how well they do. And again, this level of infestation should kill 80 to 80+% of the bees in this particular time frame. And that's essentially what we see. We're showing you survival here again. The controls were between 10 and 20% survival, maybe 25% for these. But the selected bees are surviving at about 55%. And this is a level, again, of infestation that a beekeeper wouldn't even bother continuing with that colony because they know they're not going to, it's not going to be worth their time trying to leave it alone. But these ones survive. So the lessons learned from all this, we were pleasantly surprised that the whole process worked. And actually, one thing that came out of this was that proteins seem to be working here, where efforts to use genomics, classic genomic sequencing and SNPs and QTLs hadn't worked. There's maybe lots of reasons for that. Now we're expanding this to several other different traits and extending it across the country. And just a final thank you to GLBC in Canada for all the funding. As Jenny said as well, the BC Ministry of Agriculture now is funding this as well. Many people were involved, in particular Marta, who's in the audience. But thank you for your attention.
Assessed yet. A similar outbreak in 2004 cost
about $64 million in compensation for birds lost, $3 million in lost production for each day the industry was shut down, and it's often shut down for several months in these outbreaks, $380 million in secondary revenue losses, so this is loss of poultry products not making it to market, and $150 million in downstream losses, so things like litter, hatcheries, all these various industries that support the poultry industry. Now, chickens and turkeys actually aren't the natural reservoir for AI. Wild waterfowl are, and indeed waterfowl are the natural reservoir for all strains of influenza A, and that's including the strains we know as avian influenza. They're asymptomatic carriers, and they shed the virus in their feces. And it's the ecological characteristics of waterfowl that are responsible for the distribution of frequency and unpredictability of AI outbreaks. And the one characteristic in particular is their propensity to fly around. So these are the major global migratory pathways, also called flyways. And it's because of this, these long-distance migrations that waterfowl are able to carry these viruses into new geographic locations. But even more importantly, there's transmission of AI viruses among waterfowl, not only within a flyway, but also among flyways because of these overlaps. And it's believed that these overlaps are becoming greater and greater because of global warming. And the problem with overlaps is it allows co-infection of birds with viruses that would be usually geographically disparate. So what happens is a bird might become infected with an Asian and a North American virus. They really act as a mixing vessel, facilitating reassortment of genes and the development of new viruses. And that's exactly what happened in 2014-2015. We had a new Eurasian North American hybrid, had never been seen on this continent before, and it was believed to have developed in the northern part of the flyway, where they intersect, and then migrated down through Fraser Valley and into the US. Now, because wild waterfowl are the main reservoir, they're also the target for surveillance. And there are two main current surveillance methods, both of which focus on testing individual birds. And they have a number of significant drawbacks. So the first is passive. This is actually the most common method, and this is really waiting for dead birds to fall out of the sky, race in, scoop them up, and test them for avian influenza. But I just mentioned that avian influenza doesn't kill wild birds. So this is sort of like doing human influenza surveillance in car crash victims. Is that really representative? Is that the best way to go about it? Probably not. But we do it because it's easy. Because the other methods, the active method, is capturing and testing of live birds. So if you can imagine how much effort it is to get, again, a representative sample of waterfowl, capture them live, swab them, and then release them, you can see why that has not been, had great success. The other method is hunter-kill birds. So this is, again, partnering with hunters, but you're only getting birds during the hunting season and only birds that hunters want to hunt. So again, not a great sample. And this is where our study came in. We realized we needed a new approach, and thank you. We asked ourselves, where could we get feces from a large number of waterfowl from a diverse range of species? I just want to mention before I go on that these surveillance methods were in place in advance of the 2014-2015 outbreak and failed to predict that outbreak. So we know we need this new method. So back to where we're going to get our representative sample of bird feces. Well, I would say that's the wetland, Mother Nature's outhouse. But what does the wetland have to do with farms? Well, go back to waterfowl ecology, and you'll know that birds that frequent these farms during the day and can potentially transmit viruses to domestic poultry tend to congregate and spend the night at certain wetlands. So these wetlands are, in effect, a one-stop shop for sampling birds that would otherwise be widespread during the day. So that's where our study comes in. We wanted to know if we could use genomic and molecular technology to detect and characterize AI viruses in wetland sediment. So this study actually took place during the outbreak. Thanks to GenomeC, we were able to get up and running while the outbreak was taking place.
We identified 15 wetlands that we thought would be feeder wetlands for the infected premises during the outbreak. And we went and sampled those wetlands, obtaining about 300 samples. Additionally, we were fortunate enough to partner with the Canadian Food Inspection Agency to get 41 samples from miniature wetlands on farms. So these are areas on farms where birds were seen to congregate during the day. So these samples underwent RNA extraction. They underwent a matrix-based screening PCR just to say, are they influenza positive or influenza negative? And they're in the process right now of undergoing two parallel sequencing platforms at a bioinformatics analysis so we can actually characterize the AI viruses present in those samples. So I glossed over that really quickly, and I know my colleagues at the BCCDC will groan. It seems very simple, but it really is like panning for gold. So we've had to sort through a lot of muck to get our nugget. And it's because of the support from GeneomeBC and the expertise at the BCCDC team that we've invented a really great pan to do so. So what are our results thus far? Well, the answer is we've made it happen so far. We've detected avian influenza virus in about 23 of 300 samples, or about 8%, with additional 16% being suspect positive. We're refining our methods to see if those are true positives. On the farm samples, 37% were positive, and an additional 15% were suspect positive. So these numbers are particularly gratifying when you consider that the detection rate in our current Canadian national AI surveillance program is about 1%. So much better detection. So in conclusion, we can detect AI in wetland sediments, but there's a lot of work left to do. I liken the technology at this point to the first cell phone. So great in theory, but not too useful to the general public. So our next task is really going to be refinement and validation so that we can transform this tool into a highly efficient and an effective technology that you can have in your pocket or your lab, wherever you may be. So ultimately what we want to do is to use this similarly to the Homeland Security threat level. And the reason is, people say, well, you know wild birds are the source, so why don't people just have good biosecurity? Well, Homeland Security's figured this out a long time ago. You can't operate at 100% vigilance 100% of the time. People get vigilant, and that's when things slip through the cracks. So our hope is that by actually providing an accurate threat level for the incoming migratory birds each season will provide industry and government with the opportunity to mount risk-appropriate surveillance and mitigation strategies. And with that, I'd just like to thank all of our funders and the